In the end of February 1936, four one-of-a-kind aircraft are parked on the coast of the Baltic Sea at Travemünde to compete in the German Air Ministry's 1933 requirement for a new short-range interceptor. Competition came down to a shootout between the Heinkel and their HE-112 and the underdog Bayerische Flugzeugwerke and their Bf-109, designed by Willy Messerschmitt and Robert Lusse. Less than a month later, the Bf-109 was ordered into production by the Air Ministry, and by the end of the war, the 109 would be the most produced fighter aircraft in history, a record that still survives to this very day. The aircraft was quick to achieve fame, winning multiple competitions, including aerial speed race, at the Flugmeeting Air Show in Zurich, and also set a world speed record for land planes with piston engines in November, with a speed of 379.62 miles per hour. Although it is important to note that this aircraft was fitted with a special racing engine and not the stock power plant. The aircraft was the brainchild of innovative designer Willy Messerschmitt, whose principle was focused on achieving a simple and lightweight construction. One example of this principle could be seen in the design of the landing gear, which is attached to the fuselage instead of the wing like most conventional aircraft of the day. This granted ground crews the ability to remove the wing for servicing without needing to have additional equipment on hand to support the fuselage once the wings were removed, and allowing for a simplified and superior wing construction to contemporary aircraft. A key advantage of the design was the incorporation of leading edge slats and camber changing slats on the trailing ledge of the wings, which increased the amount of lift generated by the wings, which gave the aircraft a higher wing loading and thus greater stability and maneuverability, which its small wings, which are optimal for speed, would not ordinarily allow for. As a testament to the ingenious design of the 109, Soviet machine gun technician Viktor Sinaisky had this to say.
The Messer was a very well-designed plane. First, it had an engine of an inverted type, so it could not be knocked out from below. It also had two water radiators with a well-cut-off system. If one radiator leaked, you could fly on the second, or close both down and fly at least 5 minutes more. The pilot was protected by an armor plate from the back, and the fuel tank was also behind armor. Our planes had fuel tanks in the center of their wings. That's why our pilot got burnt. What else did I like about the Messer? Well, it was highly automatic and thus easy to fly. It also employed an electrical pitch regulator, which our planes didn't have. Our propeller system with variable pitch was hydraulic, making it impossible to change pitch without engine running. If, God forbid, you turned off the engine at high pitch, it was impossible to turn the propeller and was very hard to start the engine again. Finally, the German ammo counter was also a great thing.
Indeed, the ammo counter was a great thing, as both American and Soviet test pilots who flew captured examples often praised them, lacking such systems in their own aircraft. Notable variants included the E, F, G, and K series. E-Series was the type in service at the outset of World War II and became famous for its participation during the Battle of Britain. This is the most loved variant of the 109 by the pilots who flew her. The F-Series came into service in 1941 and was a considerable redesign over the E-Series. This was the first variant to concentrate all armament in the forward section of the fuselage. G-Series was the most produced variant of the 109. K-Series was the realization of the full potential of the 109 airframe, and came into service in late 1944. The aircraft was not without its problems. An aircraft that was absolutely devastating in the hands of the masters of the type, for a rookie pilot, the plane could be quite traumatic. This reputation was caused primarily by the very narrow track landing gear design. The aircraft was thus prone to tipping over on the runway, or having its gear simply twist and collapse under itself, due to the tendency of the plane to shift horizontally during takeoff, due to an ineffective rudder. A majestic lady of the air, the 109 was a wreck on the ground, and many airframes met their ends after being declared inserviceable following a new pilot botching yet again another takeoff or landing. This problem would be somewhat remedied in later models, particularly in the G and K series, with the addition of a fixed tail wheel, but the poor forward and rearward visibility inherent in all models of the 109 did not let the pilot take full advantage of this. Yet despite all these things, the Luftwaffe fell in love with this aircraft, and when it was agreed to build the Graf Zeppelin, what would have been Germany's first aircraft carrier, the 109 was enthusiastically chosen to be navalized and operate from its decks, even with its notorious landing gear problems and bad takeoff habits, including its poor visibility. It can probably be said that many pilots were overjoyed when they heard that this idea was scrapped and they were not going to be flying 109s off the deck of an aircraft carrier. Another shortcoming that was passed down through all the plane's models was its very short range, a problem that became very apparent during the Battle of Britain when 109s could not achieve the range needed to escort attack aircraft such as Ju-88 Stukas all the way across the channel to the targets and back. While it may seem that the 109 was riddled with problems and flaws, it was actually a very solid concept and enjoyed a number of advantages over its foes in aerial combat. One of these included the use of a fuel injection system, which allowed the pilot of the 109 to push his plane nose down until he was flying inverted in the other direction. Early Spitfires could not do this, as their engines utilized a carburetor. If a Spitfire pilot were to push his nose down to the point where he was now flying inverted in the opposite direction, his plane would quickly stall and he would fall out of the air, where the 109 could then get on top of him and shoot him down. This tactic was employed by a number of 109 pilots who used the maneuver to escape whenever a Spitfire would get on their tail. While the armament of the 109 was always considered a bit light for the type, the 109 did enjoy some superiority in how its armament was placed, being focused on the center of the aircraft. The 109's typical armament consisted of two machine guns on the upper portion of the nose and one 20mm cannon firing through the propeller hub. This created a spray of fire that was concentrated from the center line of the aircraft, unlike other designs such as the Hawker Hurricane or the Supermarine Spitfire, in which the guns were located on the ring boots of each ring, creating two sprays of fire that had to converge on the target once the rounds got downrange. The aircraft first saw combat in the Spanish Civil War and enjoyed immense success that carried on into the early years of World War II. The Battle of Britain would expose some of the aircraft's flaws. The Luftwaffe's primary fighter aircraft was pressed into roles that it was never designed to fulfill, such as escort duties and photo reconnaissance. Yet the aircraft would regain its fame after its inadequacies were addressed with the release of the F-Series. The plane was particularly feared by Soviet pilots, who considered the aircraft a greater threat than the 109's much more powerful brother, the FW-190. Perhaps their fear was justified, though. While historians today attribute these ridiculous numbers to combat with outclassed and poorly trained Soviet pilots during the early years of the invasion of the USSR and the lack of escort fighters with Allied bomber groups up until 1944, a total of 15,000 kills in less than a decade is still a very impressive number, no matter how it is attained. Yet the Germans are not the only faction to have success with the type. Finnish pilots, who lacked the top-notch training of the Luftwaffe counterparts, but were empowered by the fight for their very survival of their homeland against the Soviet Union, achieved a kill-to-loss ratio of 25-1 against the Red Air Force. By the end of the war, many considered the 109 to have been obsolete, outmoded, and ineffective in comparison to the new Allied and Soviet fighter aircraft such as the North American P-51 Mustang, the Hawker Tempest, and the Yak-3 fighter aircraft. Indeed, this very much seems to be the case on paper. And as the Luftwaffe began to lose its experienced pilots and training standards slack during the end of the war, the 109 began to be shot down in flocks. Yet in the hands of a skilled pilot, it was still a solid match for the most advanced Allied models, and if not the deadliest plane in the sky. An air crew of American P-51 pilots were soon to find this out in a deadly encounter over the skies of Belgium.
January 1st, 1945. Over a forward airbase in Belgium, designated Y-29, Mustang pilot Al Rigby, with two other P-51s, have engaged the best German pilot they've ever seen.
I don't know now that I've got even a round left, but here's two P-51s mixing it up with a 109. And I mean that 109 is good.
Rigby makes diving passes at the expertly flown 109. But the German makes a mockery of his attempts, kicking the tail around and diving for airspeed before Rigby can even hope for a shot. The other Mustangs in the fight circle, making passes of their own. But the 109 evades them all, firing as opportunity allows.
The 109, for one maneuver, he rolls that thing over on his back and does a split F from what I guess to be perhaps 1,000 feet. But I can still see that 109 as he pulls that thing out, the pre-top shutter and wing trips and streamers, and he's back in the fight.
The German holds them at bay with guts and superior airmanship. The B-51s have him boxed in. Somehow, they've got to knock him out. Just then, Sandy Motes returns to the area. The expert 109 stumbles across his path.
He broke into me, that is, he turned into me in an aggressive manner. But as I turned into him to try to get behind him, he pulled straight up, which is kind of a surprise.
The 109 barrel rolls in an effort to shake the Mustang. Motes follows through the dizzying maneuver. Then, unexpectedly, the 109 chops his throttle and tumbles.
As he spun down, I thought, well, there goes number five. The simple reason, as I watch him spinning down, there's no way he could have pulled out from that low altitude. Amazingly, he did pull out. And I had no more ammunition. All I could do was look and watch.
But the stunning maneuver proves futile.
One of these P-51s fires, and I see what I think is a couple of hits on this guy. Turns him directly in front of me. He's right here. I'm right here. All I have to do is a hard left, point the nose ahead, and the last of my ammunition shatters the cockpit. I'm close enough to see the pilot, the shatter, everything.
True testament to the capabilities of the 109 and extremes that allowed its best pilots to push it to. Following the war, the 109 would continue in service in many air forces and even achieve further combat success at the hands of the Israelis, flying unreliable and poor-performing Czech-built Avia S-199 derivatives of the 109, scoring kills against Arab aircraft such as Spitfires. The last active 109s retired from service in 1960 by the Spanish Air Force. Since the conclusion of World War II, the subsequent capture and evaluation of German aircraft by the Allies, and the release of previously classified documents and information, the reputation of the Messerschmitt Bf 109 has been up in the air. The plane's legacy has been a hot topic among researchers, historians, and aircraft enthusiasts alike. A few people regard it as the world's best piston engine fighter aircraft. These people use its record as being the most produced fighter aircraft of all time. Its sheer number of aerial victories, and the vast number of aces that were made at the type's controls, as proof that their claim is legitimate. However, it seems that a more popular opinion is that the type was at least mediocre in comparison to more advanced fighters, such as the North American P-51 Mustang and the Republic P-47 Thunderbolt, two fighter aircraft that have a large fan base that all claim that the types are the best piston engine fighter aircrafts ever seen. Those who uphold this view on the 109's legacy tend to use the records of P-51 Mustangs, P-47 Thunderbolts, and Supermarine Spitfires against the 109 in the later stages of the war. It is true that at this time in the war, the 109 was mincemeat against such Allied fighters. Thus, they claim that the Bf 109 was a wholly inferior model to more advanced Allied aircraft, and that it has no place in being a part of the world's best piston engine fighter aircraft. But this group of people tends to forget to look at the eastern theater of the war, on the Russian front, where the Red Air Force was having just a staggering success against the 109. Yet, the Red Air Force also had a few successes against the very same Allied aircraft, such as the P-51 Mustang and P-47, that this same group of people likes to say are the best piston engine aircraft in the world. An interesting incident took place on April 17, 1945, when top Soviet ace, and also incidentally top Allied ace of the war, Ian Kozadob, 64 kills, encountered a formation of B-17 Flying Fortresses along with their P-51 Mustang escort fighters. Even as late into the war as this incident occurred, the shape of Ian's Latvian 7 fighter was still unknown to many American pilots, and thus the P-51 pilots mistook him as a German and began to attack him. Ian was forced to defend himself and ended up shooting down two P-51 Mustangs. Footage released from his gun camera would later show images of a P-51 Mustang smoking and going down in flames. So then, if these aircraft, such as the P-51, which is considered by many to be the best piston engine fighter aircraft in the world, are succumbing to Soviet aircrafts that are having just as equal success against the 109 as the P-51 is, then two questions are given to rise. First, are the American aircraft really the greatest piston engine fighter aircraft in the world, as people say they are? And secondly, is the 109's reputation as being a lackluster combat opponent really accurate? Or is there more going on here? The answer to the first question becomes pretty clear and fairly blunt when one does research into the types of aircrafts being flown by the Red Air Force at this time in the war. No, the American aircraft are not the greatest piston engine fighter aircraft in the world.
It's not true! That's impossible!
Search your feelings, you know it to be true.
No!
The Soviets at this point had types such as the Yak-3, Yak-9, Lavochkin 7s that outclassed the Allied fighters in many different ways. The answer to the second question, however, is much more complex, and one must draw upon multiple sources to answer it. Important information on the topic can be discerned when observing the state of the Luftwaffe through the progression of the war and through the different types of aircraft and training programs used by the air forces of various Western nations at the time. At the start of the war, German pilots were arguably among the best in the world, even though their air force had been basically axed by the Treaty of Versailles, which concluded World War I. However, the Germans had been able to secure a deal with the Russians to where they could send potential pilots to Russian Air Force bases during the interwar years where they could train and learn how to fight. The Germans would then send aid to the Loyalist factions during the Spanish Civil War of the late 1930s, which turned out to be a proving ground for the Luftwaffe, their pilots, and their newest aircraft types. Luftwaffe sent along some of the most advanced, newest German fighter types, and their pilots were able to get real combat experience flying these planes against Republican forces. This left the Luftwaffe with an experienced and well-equipped force to wield at the beginning of the war. The Soviets would also take advantage of the situation in Spain, sending large amounts of their latest aircraft along with pilots to aid the Republican forces. However, the Soviets did not gain the experience out of the venture that the Germans did, as Stalin later decided to manifest his fear of flying by purging the top ranks of the Red Air Force and the aviation design industry. This left many vacant positions in the command structure of the Red Air Force, which would then be filled by unskilled personnel who never held such positions of leadership in their military careers. Yet the most dire consequences would not be felt by the Red Air Force, but by the Soviet design bureaus, who up until this point in time had been making significant contributions to the advancement of military aircraft not only in the Soviet Union, but also in the aviation industry and profession around the world. Thus, at the outbreak of the war, the Soviet design bureaus who were left with largely unexperienced and untried designers who had difficulties creating new types of aircraft that could effectively combat German 109 and FW-190s. Over on the opposite side of the Atlantic, the United States was still getting used to the newfound global power it had. The U.S. Air Force, at this time known as the U.S. Army Air Corps, was equipped with an adequate and decent series of planes, but nothing that was extremely effective in any decisive way against some of the more advanced and modern Soviet types. At this point, the best fighter aircraft the Americans had was the Hawk series aircraft, which culminated in the P-40 model, known as the Kitty Hawk. Yet although this was a solid design concept and was well renowned for its speed, did not quite have what it took to stand up to some of the more advanced types flown by the Luftwaffe, as the RAF would soon find out in Africa. Yet the Americans possessed a very large and innovative design industry, which was constantly working on new prototypes and different ways of making fighter aircraft. The UK's Royal Air Force would start the war primarily armed with the Profound Hawker Hurricane, a type that RAF pilots found unable to compete with the performance of the BF-109. The story of the Hurricane has largely been overshadowed by the story of the Spitfire, which today is considered the great British aircraft of World War II. But the Hawker Hurricane is much more deserving of this title, as RAF pilots flew the type throughout the Battle of Britain and ended up downing more German aircraft with the Hawker Hurricane than all other British fighters and air defenses combined, a feat that on paper should have been impossible. Hurricane pilots loved their aircraft. Although they grumbled about the inability of the type to match the performance of the BF-109, they loved how the Hurricane could take massive amounts of punishment and keep flying, and also how it was able to serve as a very stable gun platform, allowing for the type to be upgraded over its lifespan with new types of very heavy weaponry. Early variants of the Spitfires were also present during the Battle of Britain, and they did combat evenly with the BF-109E, the Spitfire and the 109 creating the upper hand throughout the Battle of Britain. Yet Hurricane pilots would outshine their Spitfire contemporaries, as they were able to do combat effectively on the same level as the 109. Again, something that should have been impossible on paper, as the 109 was wholly superior to the Hurricane, and at this point in time, the 109 and the Spitfire were clearly the most advanced fighter in the air. And in fact, it was the Spitfire that was the first plane anywhere in the world to finally challenge the 109 in aerial supremacy. But in the end, it would be the Hawker Hurricanes that truly brought the battle to the Messerschmitt and earned the title the Savior of Britain. With the Battle of Britain soon stalemating, the elimination of any chance for the go-ahead for Operation Sea Lion. In mid-1941, Hitler invaded the Soviet Union with Operation Barbarossa. Once again, the 109 cleared the skies with the E and new F-series variants. Soviet pilots were shot down in numbers never before seen in aerial combat, as they flew outdated and completely outclassed Polikarpov I-16 and a Polikarpov I-153 biplanes. The stubby I-16 monoplanes, by far the more advanced of the two types, had to battle it out alone with the 109 in the skies, only to be supplemented later by a handful of Yak-1 and Lag-3 fighters. Yet the I-16 pilots did manage to do some damage to the Luftwaffe and scored a number of aerial victories, even though they gave the German aces most of their victories here. Yet the Soviet pilots did not go down without a fight and achieved some level of success, while being slaughtered at the same time. With the introduction of new Soviet aircraft types, such as the Lavochkin 5 and 7, the Yakovlev 3, 7, and 9, the tables began to turn in the Luftwaffe, as the Soviet fighter squadrons, now having largely replenished the men lost in the opening phases of the war, having rethought out their doctrines and their tactics and replaced the old ones, were now led by hardened combat veterans who had somehow managed to survive the mauling given to the Red Air Force by the Luftwaffe. On the German side, however, all is not well. Casualties sustained since the opening days of the war were finally starting to mount up, and now with the Soviets pressing their way towards Berlin, and the Allies opening a second front in Normandy, as well as moving up through the Italian peninsula, having beaten the Axis in Africa, are making it hard for the Luftwaffe to find replacement pilots and devote time, money, and resources to fighter pilot training, programs which have now seriously started to deteriorate in Germany. Then, in mid-1944, the Americans would unleash their new P-51D series Mustang, the plane that would seem to wipe the Luftwaffe off the skies and finally give protection to Allied bomber groups, as its incredible range, respectable firepower, and incredible performance figures dominated the skies over Western Europe, along with contemporaries such as the newly introduced Hawker Tempest. The Yakovlevs 3 and 9 of its German pilots were told by the superiors to avoid at all costs, along with the P-51D Mustang, P-47 Thunderbolt, and other advanced Allied aircraft such as the latest Marcus Spitfire and the Hawker Tempest. It would be the aircraft that finally brought an end to the Luftwaffe in Nazi Germany. Yet, it is interesting to note that looking at all these scenarios, in each power, the Allies and the Soviets finally started to gain success against German 109s, it was around roughly the same time, a lot of it did have to do with the introduction of new and finally competitive types against the 109's performance. The timing is also concurrent with what could be described as the beginning of the Luftwaffe's demise, most likely starting in 1943, but becoming most notable in 1944. The lack of veteran pilots in the Luftwaffe and the decline of training programs for new pilots really started to take their toll on the German war effort, as Allied squadrons were now being led by battle-hardened combat pilots. The demise of the effectiveness and the disappearance of many of the great victories seen by the 109 throughout the war at this time could best be described not as an incapability of combat effectiveness, but instead as a lack of numbers of skilled and effective pilots. It is agreed by many historians and aircraft enthusiasts that the 109 managed to attain and retain combat effectiveness against even the most advanced Allied designs such as the P-51 and Hawker Tempest. And while this was somewhat diminished over the course of the war with the introduction of these new types, it was never eliminated. The main problem lied in the fact that Germany no longer possessed pilots that knew the 109-1 enough to utilize the advantages the 109 held over the Allied types to their advantage in a dogfight. Thus, the 109 can by no means be disqualified from the list of the greatest piston engine combat aircraft of all time. However, it is by no means the greatest piston engine fighter aircraft of all time. That title once again lies to the Soviets and their Yak-3, or the Hawker Tempest Mark V, two types that never were able to duke it out over the skies with each other. But the 109 does hold a distinction that no other type does, and that no other type can ever do now that it has been made by the 109. The legacy of the 109 is that it was truly the first aircraft to show us that it is the pilot that determines the capabilities of an aircraft, that really determines the outcome of a battle, and not purely just the capabilities and performance of an aircraft. The 109 was a great example of this, in that it was able to do absolutely anything its pilots asked of it to do, as demonstrated by the German 109 fighter pilot that Al Rigby met at the Battle of Y-29. The 109, when flown by men who knew her well and had adapted to her, could be the most powerful plane in the sky that could be untouched by even the most advanced, most modern fighter aircraft such as the P-51 Mustang. This is a lesson that has endured throughout time and has been learnt by the air forces of the world, particularly by the Russians and Americans. Korea and Vietnam would clearly demonstrate this, as American pilots would have an easy time with native Korean and Vietnamese pilots, although not all of them, but encountered great difficulty with hardened and veteran Soviet pilots flying the same type of aircraft. This shall forever be what sets the 109 apart from the rest of the pack. And even though it may not be the greatest piston engine fighter aircraft ever seen, it is by far up in the top 5 of the greatest that I've ever flown, and is probably number 1 for the most loved and adored plane ever been in the hands of a combat pilot. Beginning its life well before the war, the 109 served with effectiveness and viability all the way up through to the end and was even used afterwards. Although its fame and outstanding reputation may have been delegated to the dustbin of history outside the world of aircraft and historical enthusiasts, the 109 has left a mark on the world of aviation that can never be removed and will endure throughout the rest of time. Aircraft does not win victories for the pilots. The man behind the controls wins victory for the aircraft, for their country, and for themselves. This was the Messerschmitt BF 109.